everyone. Thanks for hanging out with me. I'm Chrissy Wright, creator of Business Boutique, and I am hanging out with one of my good friends, Emily Lay. Emily, thanks so much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
Emily, I am such a fan of yours, and you know this because I sent you a message on Instagram a few months ago, but I asked all of my followers, who do you want to hear from on the podcast? Like, we love having new guests. And overwhelmingly, the response was, Emily Lay, Emily Lay, Emily Lay. I was like, well, done. We already have her scheduled, so I'm so glad. But obviously, our ladies love you. But for anyone listening or watching that is not familiar with what you do, tell us a little bit about yourself and about your business.
Well, first and foremost, I'm a mom to three kids. I have 3.5-year-old twins, Tyler and Caroline, and a 7-year-old, Brady. And I'm also the founder of Simplified, and we are a brand of planners and organizational products for busy women. And I'm also an author of 2 books, Grace Not Perfection and A Simplified Life. So it's really busy over here. We got a lot going on, and we're just really all about trying to take the really overwhelming of life and make it simple and manageable and fun and joyful. So it's a lot of fun.
And you have done an amazing job of that. Like, even your background is so simple and beautiful. Like, you are just
start to finish. You should see the rest of my house.
You have, yeah, exactly. You kind of have become this simplicity expert, truly. And I want to know the story behind that. Like, how did you get into this space, and why did you get into this space? And like, what a unique thing to go for. You know, so many people go for different things, and you're like, I'm going to take simple, and I'm going to own it, and I'm going to brand myself as that. So talk to me about how you did this.
You know, it's really funny. I think that the way all of this came to be and the way that it was really put on my heart was that I'm terrible at it. Mm. Like, my life is completely overwhelming. I have so many things going on, so many things that I want to be involved in and things I want to achieve and things I want to do with my family, goals and things like that. There's so much going on that I really hit rock bottom a couple times and had those realizations of something's got to give. I'm going to have to really pare back and get back to what really matters most to me and find ways to organize my life, to add some structure and routine and rhythm that allows me to do all of those things and do them well without failing at one or the other. So it was basically out of necessity.
Yeah. Out of you living this yourself. And I love that. It's funny. People think that I speak on life balance because I'm an expert at life balance. I'm like, I speak on life balance because I feel very out of balance most of the time. And, you know, a lot of times we teach what we're living out in our own life, which is why you have so many stories and examples and things you're learning, you know, alongside the women that follow you. So I love that. I'd love to know from your experience of now that you've been in this space and you've worked with thousands of women, helping them truly simplify their life through your, you know, through your resources, but also just through your teaching. I would love to know, are there any like habits that women tend to have that make their life more complicated or make it more stressful? Or are there mistakes we make or tendencies we have that, like, we make this hard on ourselves and we're not even aware that we're doing it?
Right. Absolutely. I think the first one that comes to mind is we put ourselves last. I mean, so many of us have things that we love and we want to pour into, and families and work, and we pour and we pour and we pour and we give and we give and we overcommit to the point to where we are completely empty as people.
Right.
And as a woman especially, I think that that's just detrimental.
Right.
And it's a backward way of thinking. By the way, again, I only know this because I've completely fallen on my face in it. I've been at that place where I felt completely depleted. And I've given everything to everyone else. I haven't taken care of myself, my body, my soul, my faith. Like, I've put all of that last, almost in the sense that I'm doing the right thing by putting it last. Like, it's the noble thing to do as a mother or as a woman, to volunteer so much and to give so much. And really, it should be the other way around.
Right.
For me to be good for those people and for those things that I care so much about, I have to take care of myself first. And it's, I would say, just a completely transformative realization when you hit that place where you say, it's time. Like, it's time to take care of me too.
I love that example, and I've certainly done all of those things you just described, and I've worked with women that do this, that same thing, and we have this, like, I don't know, this Mother Teresa complex, right? Like, we want to be Mother Teresa, we want to be the hero, we want to be everything to everyone, but what happens is, and I've seen this happen in my own life, I love how you described it as empty, where I've been empty, I have nothing left to give, but I also get grumpy. Like, I get resentful and bitter, and I'm mad because I'm out with my friends and I don't have any makeup on, but it's because I spent the last 20 minutes vacuuming the floors before I left rather than putting on makeup where I would feel good.
And
it's just so practical and silly, but it's also, as you say, you know, so simple. It's some of these simple changes that we can make where you do take care of yourself first, and then everyone benefits. You're a better wife. You're a better mom. You enjoy your life more. It's the whole flying oxygen mask example. You put your oxygen mask on yourself first before someone else. But to your point, it feels so wrong. You know, it feels so backwards. So like, that's selfish. But what you're saying, and what I've certainly experienced in my life, is it's not selfish. It's actually self-preservation. And it's really smart to do that where you take care of yourself. Now, I know that you're living all of this out, like you say, and a lot of it comes from personal experience. What are some mistakes you've made? Or what are some areas of your life that are particularly stressful or overwhelming where it's like, you know, you really try to get ground there, but it always seems to be kind of one of those pain points for you? Because I'm sure people are listening to you and watching you thinking, oh, well, she's a simplicity expert. Like, her bookshelves are perfect. Like, she does not have any problems. Like, tell us about some of the things that you've learned along the way.
You know, I'm going to start messing up these bookshelves. the hardest thing for me right now is parenting. Mm. I mean, I have 2 3-year-olds. It's a lot. It is just a lot. And we're moving, and we have this growing business and this team we're working with. And there's just so many things going on that I find I lose my patience parenting because it's so hard to control.
Right.
Like, I want them to fall in line. I want them to be peaceful, and they just want to fight, and it's so funny. Brian, my husband, and I always say, we used to say, like, God's gonna give us one child that's like really quiet and really easy, but he didn't. God was like, you guys got this. I'm giving you 3 kids with 3 huge personalities. And it's so much fun, but at times it's the hardest thing.
Yeah.
And so what I've had to learn is how to turn work off, turn mom on, turn work off, turn mom on, and be 100% in each of those areas while I'm doing those particular things. It's impossible to do all of the things at the same time.
Right.
That's been a big lesson for me. And another one is also, there's just so much noise in my house. Yeah. Like, there's people making noise, there's phones making noise, there's TVs and radios, and just there's so much noise, there's information coming at us. And so learning how to dial that back and quiet the house, can't really quiet the kids, but quiet the phones, turn all the notifications off, unsubscribe from the emails, just dialing that back so that there is a sense of peace in some form has been, you know, another life-changing thing.
Yeah, it's crazy because I think that you're right, at least for my life, it's the same way, it's the parenting. It's like, I can't control everything at work, but I can control a lot. Yeah. You know, I can control my schedule. I can control, you know, what projects we're working on. I can speak into decisions that we make. I can, at some level, control my house and the cleanliness of it when the kids are asleep. I can get it clean. It won't stay clean, but I can get it clean for a minute.
Right.
I can enjoy it for a second. But man, those little human beings, they have minds of their own and personalities of their own and opinions of their own. And, you know, one of the things that really trips me up, Emily, and as much as I try to get over this, I never do. Like, I just am, I have these ideas in my head of how things are going to go.
Right.
And then they never go like that. And then I'm always disappointed. You'd think I'd learn things aren't going to go like that. So stop expecting them to go like that. So, it's Easter and they're going to come down the stairs in their little Easter pajamas. They're going to be in the best mood. They're going to follow the little trail of eggs. Oh. They're going to be delighted at their Easter basket. They're going to think I'm the best mom. Then we're going to all get in our perfect outfits and go to Easter Sunday at church.
Matching.
We're going to take pictures where everyone smiles. Why do I think that, Emily? Why do I think that? That is never going to happen. Not even one of those things will happen.
No.
And so I just, a lot of times for me, the stress comes from having an expectation that is not realistic and then being disappointed when it doesn't meet that versus saying, we're going to wake up, it's Easter morning, and we're going to somehow get our family to church. Success.
Yeah.
That's a success. I don't know what they're wearing. I don't know how they're acting. They're probably crying, with chocolate bunny on their face. That's fine. We got there.
That's fine.
Yeah. And just finding the ability to give yourself grace and reset expectations because to your point, parenting is hard, and these are real human beings. It's not a project you can control. They're people that don't do what you want them to do all the time.
Amen. And we just have to find the joy in the mess of it all. And that's so hard for the recovering perfectionist here that I'm with you. I got you matching pajamas to come down the stairs to go and find the perfectly, photographed Easter basket. And really, that's not what it's about, number one. And number two, who cares about all that stuff?
Right.
And that, obviously, I'm speaking to myself here, but it's taken me a long time to get to that place where I'm like, get downstairs, let's do the Easter baskets, and let's get to church. I'm
right.
with you.
Right, yeah. It's so funny how they'll just, you just have to laugh it off because it's not just like, oh, that was that one scenario. It's an everyday thing.
All,
you know,
yeah.
My dad got my son for his birthday one of those ride-on motorcycles, you know, like this really cool police car. It has lights and stickers. I mean, it's like, it's a really cool gift. And so he was up in the bonus room and we had put it all together. And I was like, okay, like I was going to video him. And I was like, okay, we're gonna send a video to Papa in Florida. You know, they live down there. And show him, oh, he got you a gift. It's such a cool gift. I was like, what do you think it is? And he was like, maybe a dinosaur? And I was like, maybe. Anyway, so we go downstairs, and I'm videoing him. He comes around the corner. He sees this, you know, police motorcycle with the lights going. He goes, well, it's not a dinosaur.
Sounds like my
and
health.
I was like, delete video. Delete video. Right. We are going to try to muster up some excitement before I send this to my parents, you know, that they've got this gift for you. Mm-hmm. But it's an everyday thing. And like you said, we just kind of have to laugh it off. You know, Emily, I think a lot of women listening, I know a lot of women that you work with and women that I work with, they are juggling so many things. They've got the parenting thing going, but they also have 50 other things going on. And they may really need simplicity in their life. They may really need to get organized and just simplify, get a handle on things where they feel like, okay, I've got at least a little bit of this under control. To women like that, where would they start? Like, I know you teach on a lot of different ways to simplify.
Right.
What is your, like, starting point for someone going, Emily, I'm drowning. Where do I begin?
Yeah. First and foremost, physical clutter is mental clutter.
Okay.
So if you feel cluttered in your head or like it's time to pump the brakes, it's time to like take inventory of what's going on and start in your home. No matter what your home looks like, how big or small or wonderful it is, start in the most used room of your house, start in your kitchen, and start decluttering. And honestly, like the kitchen can be a little overwhelming. So I would even back that up a little bit and say, start with a trash bag or two and just start walking the house.
Okay.
First thing, you pick up trash because, you know, we're picking up hangers and, or like, you know, trash from the store or receipts or whatever, and throw it in the trash bag. Just do one big sweep of your house. And then walk around with a donate bag. Okay. If you see things that obviously don't need to be there, walk around with a donate bag. Third step, last step, is to walk around with a laundry basket. So take a huge laundry basket. We actually do this every night in my house. It's how everyone participates. It's how we get the house back to square one for the next day. Sometimes it takes longer than others. But you take the laundry basket and walk your house and throw anything in the laundry basket that's out of place. Dirty clothes, car keys laying around, cups that need to go in the dishwasher, throw everything in the laundry basket, then take the laundry basket into the living room, dump it out, sort it by room, and start putting it away.
Okay.
It's a lot faster than like, everyone go clean the kitchen, everyone go clean the bedroom. But by doing those sweeps of the house, it can literally take you 15 minutes. Mm-hmm. Might take you a little longer to put them away, but just doing that gets you back to a place of feeling a little bit refreshed. Like, okay, I did something actionable to make life a little easier, to make my face feel a little more rejuvenating.
Right.
And it just helps us refresh our minds a little bit and get, if you're ready to like really start decluttering, we lead a Ruthless Declutter Challenge on Instagram every year. And that's where we really dig in to like start in the kitchen.
Yeah.
You only need one ice cream scoop. You don't need four.
Right.
Like going through all of those things. It sounds super tactical and like, okay, Emily, that's wonderful and helping me like organize my home. But honest to goodness, that kind of digging in and dealing with emotional baggage attached to stuff will not only reset your brain in sense of like, okay, I feel like I can start fresh here. I feel like I can rest in my home and not feel overwhelmed by it. But it also just kind of resets our system a little bit and makes us think about like, okay, what kind of money am I spending on things?
Right.
Like, what am I overcommitted to with like all of these like soccer balls laying around?
Right.
It just helps us kind of take a look at the rest of life and say, okay, let's take inventory of all of these things and see what we can eliminate and how we can prune life to get back to what really matters.
Thanks so much for watching, and don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel. And if you need help protecting your time and your schedule, I have a free download for you. It's called 25 Ways to Protect Your Time. You can download that at the link below.